many of us have questions about who we really are.
Sometimes I lay there just thinking, where have I come from?
I'm desperate to know.
And what our future holds.
I don't look like anybody in my family.
Now, amazing advances in DNA technology mean those questions can be answered for the very first time. You were in a concentration camp when you were a kid.
From 9 months old.
From our families.
I didn't think that my parents were secretive.
To our ancestry.
For my whole life, I've not known. Where am I from?
To our health.
It's really crazy for a blood test to decide my future.
Working with leading geneticists, genealogists, and doctors,
we have the results.
We're going to help people unlock life-changing secrets.
Wow. My dad is capable of doing this stuff. Does that mean I am?
Through the power of a DNA test.
This is going to be the hardest case I have ever been involved in.
Our DNA doesn't lie.
Oh my goodness.
It was really clear.
Really?
But are we ready for the truth?
Oh my God.
Oh, I can't wait, to be honest. That's the trailer for the second series of the brilliant, the hit DNA Family Secrets. Next week on BBC Two, you'll see Leicester's very own genetics expert, Professor Turi King, help unlock lifelong secrets around people's true identities. Turi will be meeting people across the UK as they find out about their heritage, track down missing relatives, detect debilitating diseases, essentially before it's too late. I am thrilled to say that Turi, who is just a great person and great friend, is on the show. Turi, hi.
Hello.
Now, the thing is, we did anticipate you coming into the studio, but other things have conspired that you're now sitting looking over a car park in Italy.
This is true. I'm filming a television series, and on the very last day of filming for episode 5, we all test in the mornings before we go out, and I tested positive. So now I have to isolate in my hotel room in Italy. And unfortunately, it's not overlooking something really amazing. It's a car park.
But you do have access to the pizzeria downstairs, and the production team of the TV show you're working on out there brought you a glass of wine.
They did. They brought me a bottle of wine.
Oh, well, listen, thanks ever so much for coming on. It's really, really kind of you, because I knew it was coming, but then I saw the trailer on BBC Two maybe late last week, and I thought, I can't believe, A, that the next series has come around so quickly. But it was one of those, and I use the word in the nicest sense, it was an unexpectedly big hit, wasn't it? I think people really sort of chimed with it.
It's hugely popular, and I'm so proud of it. It's such a wonderful show.
Look, for people that didn't see it, and if you didn't, then where were you? It's on iPlayer. Give us an idea of the premise of it and the kind of things that you found out in the last series, so we don't give anything away for this one.
So essentially, people come to us with a question. So it might be something like, I've been adopted, or we had the lovely Bill last year. He knew that his dad was an African-American GI, but didn't know who he was or what had happened to him. And these days, what you can do is you can do DNA testing, and it allows you for people who match you, who share bits of DNA with you, and they must be related to you. And from that, you can build family trees, and you can start to home in on people that help you answer your questions. So for example, for Bill's one, we found people in the US who were clearly from his biological father's family. And from that, we were able to home in on who his biological father was. His father had sadly passed away, but we were able to put him in touch with cousins and things like this.
The thing it strikes me is that all of the people that are featured in it have lived successful lives. They're much loved. They've got families of their own, often children of their own. And just they all seem like, you know, amazingly grounded people. But the one thing that was missing for all of them, and correct me if I'm wrong, that was that tether to something. Do you know what I mean? Like they're floating around on a boat without a rope to get back to the shore. That's the way I kind of imagined it. Would that be right?
And that's a lovely analogy, because you do have your harbors, don't you? And having that kind of tether to, you know, who you are, and you do really feel it. So Margaret, for example, in the last series was, oh my goodness, when she came to us, she had been adopted and she just wanted to find her mom. But the longing in her voice, but all she wanted was a name and a photo. And we were able to find her mom, and her mom was still alive. And it was incredibly bittersweet, because her mom was alive but had dementia. But after filming finished and once COVID restrictions lifted, she was able to go to Ireland and meet her biological mom, you know, and hold her hand and sing to her. And it was really, really sweet. And you could honestly, this feeling of longing that came from Margaret and then being able to answer those questions and to give her that tether back to land. She got closure. She was at peace. And I think that's really important to be able to give that to people.
Look, let's be clear. This is a TV show. It's an entertaining show, isn't it? Once you start to watch it, you can't stop it. But we're dealing with really serious, amazing, life-changing stuff here. And that doesn't often happen on a telly. And for you, you know, you're the person that's doing this research that's changing people's lives. What does that feel like?
So first of all, we have a team, thank goodness. It's not just me. We've got social workers and, you know, genealogists and counsellors. I mean, we have this huge support team behind this. But yeah, oh my goodness, I tell you what, I get home from filming and I am emotionally exhausted. And goodness knows what it's like for them. It must be the same. You know, for them, they come in, they're nervous. You know, they don't know what they're going to get. And you can see right in front of your eyes that this kind of who they are is shifting and how they kind of see themselves, where they are in the world. And it's a really big shift for them. It's incredibly emotional. I feel this massive responsibility. And they're often in tears. We're in tears. The production crew is often in tears. And we sometimes have to stop. Oh, it's a big deal. Yeah.
Look, it strikes me from a career perspective, and for people that don't know, you were one of those people that was absolutely at the core of the discovery of King Richard III in the car park in the middle of Leicester and so on. And you are an internationally renowned scientist. For a lot of your career, this has been about trying to ascertain, A, through DNA, but also your fascination with genealogy as well. You're talking about dead people. To be dealing with live people, it's a bit of a sea change, isn't it?
Well, no, so my PhD was on the link between genetics and surnames. So I have been doing this kind of genetic genealogy for over 20 years, but it was taking people with the same surname and looking to see using their DNA whether or not they were related to one another. So I've been connecting family trees for people, you know, quietly through my research for over two decades. That can be a really lovely thing. So David Attenborough took part in my PhD project. And if you look at Attenboroughs around the country, yeah, about 90% of them are related to one another. Wow. And what's really lovely is somebody can come to me and say, my surname is Attenborough. Am I related to the Attenborough family? And I can go, oh, I can tell them whether or not they are or not. And then they can try and look for the genealogical links to try and match them into the tree. So the kind of the ancient DNA has run alongside. It's been a more recent thing. I started doing the sort of ancient DNA in the last sort of decade and a bit, Richard being the most famous, obviously. But yeah, no, this genetic genealogy is something that which I've been involved with for a really long time. I love it. I think it's great.
Trying to skirt around the next series. I don't want to do any spoilers for our listeners, but I don't want to do any spoilers for me, if I'm brutally honest. But there is one, and we heard it in the trailer there, and I don't know whether you can flesh out any details on it, but you said it was one of the most difficult cases you'd ever dealt with.
Jackie, who saw the first series and emailed me, and he was one of the Windermere children, so children who were brought back from Germany after the war, orphans, and later adopted, and he later found out, you know, that he was a Holocaust survivor, and basically wanted to learn more about his family. And he had some kind of pretty interesting questions. And did any of his family survive? Could DNA find anything out about his family? And the Holocaust, you learn about it at school. You learn about it when you're growing up and you hear the number about 6 million Jewish people being killed. But this really makes it hit home because you are trying to trace the family tree and you see relative after relative going on the transports. Some of the ones that are in there, you know, they didn't even bother to keep the people alive. They just took them off the trains and killed them. And it is utterly heartbreaking to read all of that. So it's that thing, trying to trace these family members when so many of them were killed, so they didn't have the children who would then go on to take the DNA tests and be on the databases. So that was an incredibly difficult and hugely emotional case to do.
Turi, I know we're going to stay in touch during the series. So it starts next Wednesday, BBC Two at 9 o'clock.
That's right.